regulating your pulsations. Remember, daily you are asked to sit down and practice something, the contraction and expansion. Now the next step, observe your respiration. There is automatically a contraction and expansion of your lungs. You are not doing it, but the inner you are doing it. The Lord is doing it, not the negative fellow doing it. And begin to observe and enjoy it, and try to cooperate with it. Establish a music, a beat, a rhythm in your respiration. Begin to inhale slowly in a soft, prolonged way, a very smooth way, with uniform speed. Begin to inhale like that, as long as you can inhale conveniently, and then begin to exhale exactly in the same way, slow, soft, uniform. In such an artistic and skillful way that you do not listen the sound of your respiration at all. Again, begin to breathe like that. But no kumbhaka business is here. Patanjali has never prescribed any kumbhaka. And for the consequences of our doing kumbhaka, Patanjali is not responsible. So, if you begin to practice this, at the same time, observing the movements of your respiration with your mind, that is most important part of it. If you do it without observing this, when your mind is wandering somewhere else, even you do it for 30 years, it is useless. It is like the motor car lifted on jockeys. Oh, better not to know. Say, for your information, you should promise me that you won't do it. See, after receiving it, you are asked to block it for some time. Self-smothering.
Okay.
That is called kumbhaka technically, which is not described either in Patanjali or Bhagavad Gita. So, when you do this practice, you be observing the movements of your lungs. Question yourself, who is making the movement? You will receive the answer, the I am in you. I am doing it. And then do it for 5 minutes. And then while inhaling, you mentally think of a sound. So while exhaling, you mentally think of the sound hum. As long as you are inhaling, mentally think of so like that. And when you begin to exhale, mentally think of hum. Until you complete, do it for 5 minutes. And next, the third 5 minutes, you leave off the consonants and select the nasal and the vowel. The sound om is left there. The next 5 minutes, that is third 5 minutes, you mentally think of om as long as you are inhaling. And vocally utter om as long as you are exhaling. That is, while you are inhaling, mentally utter om continuously. While you are exhaling, vocally utter om continuously as long as you exhale. At the same time, listen to it. completely and continuously. While uttering Om, you should listen to your own Om. This is what is called the practice of pranayama. Then what happens is the music or the rhythm in your respiration is re-established. It was there in your childhood, but it has been disturbed 1,000 times a day while you are becoming an elder. Whenever you are angry, it is disturbed. Whenever you are jealous, it is disturbed. Whenever you are afraid of something, it is disturbed. Whenever you are anxious of catching a train or a plane, it is disturbed. Not less than 1,000 times in the day, we disturbed it. According to the law of habit formation, the disturbance has established as a habit in us, and the result is cardiac disturbances, missing beats of the heart, and unequal respiration. So, as we have grown as into adult age, we lost the rhythm and the music in our respiration. Now we can re-establish it by practicing. Then, after some months of practice, automatically the respiration stops. Don't be afraid, you will be living. But the respiration stops for some time. As long as the mind is one with the function of respiration, the respiration stops. When the mind is once again different from your respiration, again it begins to respire. Don't enforce this stopping of respiration. You are not the maker. The Lord in you, He knows better than you. Let Him do it. And it is possible only when you establish a regularity in your daily routine. See, imagine you are 24 hours like a clock. Have 1, 2, 3, or 4 items in the daily routine established regularly at the same time daily. And you have established a polygon of your routine. Keep up the polygon. Gradually add one more item and make the polygon wider. Add one more item. Like this, make as many items of your daily routine as possible, regularized. Then only the stopping of respiration is possible. Unless the activity is regularized, unless the mind is regularized, it is not possible for the respiration to stop by itself and start once again. If you begin to enforce stopping respiration in the name of Kumbhaka, it is highly dangerous and the results will be disastrous in course of time, because it is quite opposing to the activity that is going on inside, and we are not expected to enforce our intelligence upon the Lord who is working inside. Every defaultation has its own penalization. This practice is called pranayama. This is the pranayama according to Patanjali and Bhagavad Gita. Next item, fifth item, after practicing for about 2 or 3 months, then you begin to practice the next thing. That is, bring the mind, bring the activity of the senses to the mind back. If there is some photo existing here, if the eye is looking at it, withdraw the eye into the mind. While opening the eye, you will be able to do it very easily. At this juncture, your ears are exposed to sounds, but you can be away from listening to the sounds. So the fivefold activity can be cut off by yourself, because you can invite the senses into the mind at this stage. For example, all the while the carpet is there before your eyes, but you have not seen it. Even though your eyes are open and the carpet is before your eyes, it never attracted your eyes, because you allowed your sight to be engaged with the mind. It is quite natural to do so, and you will be able to do it easily. Bring the senses into the mind. What happens? The senses lose their existence and mind exists, because the activity of the senses is nothing but the mental activity projected through an instrument. It is the mind that is seeing through the eye. Therefore, when you attract the sense activity into the mind, it is like drawing the water into the reservoir through the taps once again. The senses lose their identity until you permit them to exist, and only the mind exists. Now the mind exists with you. This is the fifth step, which is called Pratyahara. Pratyahara means inviting back, inviting the activity of the senses back. It is not controlling the senses. You cannot control by closing your eyes, because the mind is thinking of other things. One guru asked the disciple to come without eating and drinking in the morning, because to receive an initiation. The disciple was not accustomed not to eat early in the morning. And then the guru asked, close your eyes and do you see anything? The disciple said, a petty bread, a cup of coffee and a banana, because he has not eaten. So it is not the way how to control the mind. If we close our eyes, we can more clearly see the other things not required. So this is the way how to control. This is called Pratyahara. You will be able to maintain that mind as long as you want. This is not concentration. This is relaxation of the lower mind upon the background of the Lord. And then the next step is apply this mind upon something you prescribe, not upon what the senses prescribe. Now you prescribe some shape or some sound or some name or some science or some subject, and apply this to that particular prescribed subject. Gradually, that subject begins to germinate in you. You will learn that science without much studying the books. That is what is called the sixth step. It is called Dharana. Pratyahara is called absorption, and Dharana is called contemplation. Suppose you apply it to the candle. The candle exists in the mind with all the light. You can keep the candle burning as long as you want, and you can know how to make the candle and the contents of the candle by applying like that. What is the formula of the chemicals of the candle and how to make it? Step by step, all the details will reveal to your mind. similarly any signs. And then the next step is seventh step, that the candle exists and you do not exist. That is, the observer does not exist to himself. Only the object exists. To the total absence of the observer, the object only exists. That is called dhyana or meditation. This is meditation. Closing the eyes is not meditation. When the object of meditation exists, to the total absence and disappearance of the meditator from the mind, that is called dhyana or meditation. Then the next step. The candle exists and no other thing exists. Other thing means the observer and the object of observation. There is no other thing, there is only one thing existing. Upon anyone, any subject, you project your mind. The mind stands upon that subject because of the sixth step. And you will disappear from your perception and the object exists because of the seventh step. That is the only way how to know the Lord omnipresent. When more than one thing exists in the mind, how can the mind know the one existence? Unless you practice the seventh step and make a real experience of it, you can never know the fifth, sixth and the seventh of the seven planes of existence, which we discussed yesterday. That is called the soul experience. Now, the next step. No doubt, the candle exists in the seventh step. In the next step, the name candle disappears. Only the candle without a name exists. The color of the candle disappears. Only candle exists. And the name of the flame disappears. Flame exists. The shape disappears from your mind. Candle exists. And the flame and the candle disappear. One thing exists. Because candle and the flame are two, but the totality of the candle exists to you. No doubt all the parts exist in your observation, but the parts disappear and the total existence will be in your mind. That is the eighth step called samadhi. In English, we call it attainment. Attainment. In English, you can use the word attainment. So, contemplation, meditation, attainment. Absorption, contemplation, meditation, attainment. Don't think these are chronological phenomenon. Don't think you will get these things one after another. Sometimes you will get two at a time or three at a time. And the last three steps can be made to exist simultaneously. The sixth, seventh and eighth steps can be made to exist simultaneously. That is called simultaneity of existence. In Sanskrit, it is called samyama. Here, today, we stop because the time is too much. Though time stopped to exist, it begins to act the moment we stop the lecture. You have to travel a long way, each of you. Wherever the lecture may be tomorrow, we will complete this lesson in a proper way so that the syllabus is properly and justifiably completed. There is only matter for one lesson, and tomorrow we will complete it. Thank you all. So that the senses lose their identity in the mind. Then the mind begins to reflect towards the real center, the real I am, or the positive I am. And when the withdrawal starts, we understood how to make a total surrender to the real I am, who is also called the Lord. The method of making a total surrender to the real I am is to make the respiration uniform in the according to the process of pranayama, which we described yesterday. And in the process, we begin to withdraw the senses into the mind. The process of which is called absorption. Then we will have the experience of our real existence for the first time. Then it is said we are able to exist as ourselves through time. Instead of the environment presenting itself to the mind, we are in a position to prescribe the environment to ourselves. We are able to ask the mind to expose itself to anything we want, but not anything that is presented by the environment. So, in the course of this process, the pairs of opposites disappear, which we call pain and pleasure, success and failure, heat and cold, and the various impressions of others about us, and our various impressions about others. For the first time, the mind exists without any impressions. For the first time, you will know that you are a light. The mind, and the mind is your flame. So to say, you will understand that you are self-luminous. You have a light of your own, transmitting from yourself out in the form of the mind into the senses. Then you will understand that the same light is existing in everyone, in the name of the real I am in everybody. Then you will come to understand that only one existence is existing in everyone. This is called the existence of the Lord in all. That's why Patanjali calls it the Lord consciousness. Now, it is your duty to apply this to something. Prescribe something to your mind to work upon. Now, the mind is your secretary. Previously, the mind was the manager and proprietor. It never allowed you to remember that you exist. That is why you existed in the form of your mind and senses. You are not permitted to exist as yourself, but you are permitted only to exist as your environment, ever changing. So, you were also ever changing. Now, when you know the art of withdrawing the mind within yourself, in the name of absorption, the easiest method is to utter the call of the Lord. The sound Om is described as the call of the Lord. When you practice uniform breath through pranayama and you begin to utter Om vocally, at the same time listening to your own voice, then you will begin to understand that you are uttering Om. Then you will understand that you are uttering it with your breath. Then you will understand you are not breathing, but there is an inner yourself who is breathing. He is breathing for you because he wants to make your body and mind live. He wants your body and mind for himself. It belongs to him and not to you. This you will come to understand. And as you listen to the call of the Lord, you will understand that it is a call from the Lord, not from you. That is the next stage of your understanding. Because the respiration is starting from him and not from you, the voice and the call also start from him, not from you. That is what you understand. It is something peculiar. At first, you will begin to call him with that sound. When you begin to listen to it, you will understand that the call is coming from him and you are listening. And you will understand that he is knocking at your door to look at him. This is the next step. Then the senses are automatically withdrawn into the mind. And the mind is automatically withdrawn into the light, real I am. This is what is called meditation. Then you apply this state of existence to something you want to apply. Most preferably, a sentence from any scripture or a sentence from any good book you like or a thought or a concept. For example, there is the sentence, I am the way in the gospel. You apply this, your state of existence to that sentence. You will find the Lord teaching that sentence. Mysteriously enough, the sentence stands without any change. There is no distortion or disturbance as long as you want to make the sentence stand. Similarly, when you apply this to the face of your friend in your mind, the face stands in time without getting blurred in your mind. Because it is not an impression from outside enforced upon your mind, but it is a proposition from within stamped on the mind. So you are the master and you are no more the slave of environment. The next step is you think about the meaning of the sentence. For example, I am the way. Or love thy neighbor as thyself. Then the thinking process will be very sane and consistent. And you can take the picture of sunrise or sunset in your mind. Any picture which can purify and make you brighter. Then it stands along with the concept you prescribed to the mind. That is what is called meditation. The next step is you will disappear from your recollection and the object of your meditation only exists. And when this happens, there is only the existence of one thing, not two things. Previously, when we were in the reaction state, we had three items in our activity. The thinker, the thought, or the object of thought, and the process of thinking. When you are eating, you have three things. Yourself, the one who eats, and the food which is the object of eating, and then the action of eating. When you are seeing also, the same thing happened. Yourself the seer, and the object of what you see, and the process of seeing. So, three things were inevitable when you were in the reaction state. But when we come to the stage of meditation, only two things are existing. That is the object of meditation and the person who meditates. The process of meditation is eliminated from the mind. That is what is called meditation. So, the one factor disappeared. Then the next step is, you will disappear from your recollection. The object of your meditation remains. You will not be there for yourself. That is